أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين. صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، يا رحمة الله الواسعة، ويا باب نجاة الأمة، ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة، يا مظلوم يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء، يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وأنكحوا الأيام منكم والصالحين من عبادكم وإمائكم إن يكونوا فقراء يغنيهم الله من فضله. صل على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
I second for the love of Imams Al-Hasan Wal-Husayn. A third for the love of Fatima al-Zahra with your loudest voices.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
A person's wedding is the most important event in that person's life to most people. That day is an extremely significant day. It's a day in which two people will abandon celibacy and will announce their love and loyalty to one another. It is a day in which they will begin a life together full of love and harmony. Indeed, it's a significant day. For young ladies, they think of their wedding day long before that day. From their childhood, perhaps early teens, early teenage years, a young lady thinks about her wedding day. She fantasizes about the wedding, the dress, the cake, the ring, and let's not forget the husband as well. She does imagine him as well, his qualities, his characteristics, what he looks like. These are thoughts that a young lady thinks about when she's young. When she's a teenager, She imagines all the little details, all the intricate details of what her wedding will look like. Where will it be? On the beach? At a very expensive hotel? At a hall? Where exactly? All the little details she thinks about. And obviously, it's a very important day for her, because all of the attention is on her. Everyone at the wedding, men, women, children, they give her the attention. It's one day that she has everyone's attention. Everyone's looking at her. It's her special moment. She has to look beautiful. And usually women, they treasure the way they look on their wedding. 20 years later, they still remember. They have pictures. They save the pictures. And they remember to show the husband, "See, this is what I used to like. This is what you married." Remember? They treasure the beauty that they had on the wedding day, because it's the most important day in a woman's life. And the same thing goes for young men. For young men, yes, perhaps they don't fantasize about their weddings when they're teenagers. They don't think of all the details of their weddings, of their wedding when they're young. But still, their wedding is a very important day. It's the day they make a vow that they will no longer be single. They abandon the days of being bachelors. They're no longer a bachelor. Today, they've picked up a major responsibility, a huge responsibility. They're starting a family. They're starting a new life. They're about to share their life with someone they love. They're about to start a family, have children. Thus, for men and women, the wedding day is an extremely important day. However, as important as it is, as important as the wedding day is, it's one of the most significant days of our lives, if not the most significant day of our lives, this doesn't mean that it's an exception to Allah's laws and Allah's rules. It's the most important day in our life, but it doesn't mean that we can disobey Allah on that day. And we can do things that are haram on that day that which we wouldn't do on other days. No. Your wedding day is just like any other day. It's not an exception to Allah's laws. The same way that you have to obey Allah on other days, you have to obey Allah on your wedding day. In fact, your wedding day is a holy day, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encouraged us to get married. And on our wedding, when a person marries, he completes half of his what? Half of his faith. Thus, it's a holy day, it's a religious day. On your wedding, you're completing half of your faith. Thus, it's an extremely important religious day as well. But unfortunately, we see a lot of people on their wedding, on their wedding day, they commit a lot of sins. And they break a lot of Allah's rules and commands on that day. No wonder many weddings end up in divorce. No wonder that half of weddings, half of marriages today end up in divorce. If you start off your marriage with the disobedience of Allah, what do you expect? What do you expect of this marriage? To be full of blessings and barakah? No. You started off on the wrong track. You started off on the wrong track. So what do you expect from this marriage? Obviously, it's not going to work up, you know, it's not going to end up well. Tonight, my dear brothers and sisters, I'd like to talk about some of the un-Islamic habits, some of the unlawful habits that we have at our weddings. The things that we do at our weddings that are un-Islamic, unlawful, illegal, religiously legal, and that could end up destroying our marriage from the beginning. Now, of course, wedding habits and wedding customs, they vary from culture to culture. In the Indo-Pakistani culture, you know, you have certain customs at your wedding. In Iraq, you have certain wedding practices. In Iran, in Lebanon, Here in America, in Canada, sorry, I sometimes mix between America and Canada. I still think that I'm in America. Here in Canada or America, which is, you know, the culture is very similar, you have certain practices, you have certain habits, wedding habits. However, a lot of them, they have one thing in common, a lot of things in common, and that's there are certain things that are done that disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are certain things that are done that are haram. What are these things? We will try to summarize them in several points. Wa sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Number one, music. You will rarely enter a wedding that does not have music. Rarely. You go into a wedding and music is not being played. Only a handful of youth that choose not to have music part of their weddings, and they play something else, an nasheed or religious songs, not so much music, but the vast majority from various cultures, whatever culture you go to, many of them, they have music in their weddings. Some go far as to bring a DJ in their wedding. Have a DJ play music in their wedding. Some of them are willing to spend a lot of money on music at their wedding. My dear friends, music is haram. Whether it's at a wedding or at a funeral, music is haram. Whether it's at work or at the gym or in your car or on your phone, music is music, and music is haram. And there are no exceptions. There's no exceptions. Weddings are not exceptions to the permissibility of music. There are some people who think that music is haram unless it's at a wedding. If it's at a wedding, it's okay. Raise the volume. It's fine. Who told you? Who told you weddings are exceptions? Weddings are not exceptions. Music is haram wherever you go. وَاجْتَنِبُوا قَوْلَ الزُّورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and avoid vain talk. A hadith of Ahlul Bayt say this is music. This is singing and music. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. In Surah Al-Mu'minun, among the qualities of the mu'mineen, the believers, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. Those who avoid vain talk, vain speech. Narrations of Ahlul Bayt say this is music. This is singing. Let me ask a question. At your wedding, you're starting a new life with a new person. Do you want shayateen to be present or do you want angels? Ask yourself this question. Who do you want present? Do you want shayateen? Have all the music that you want. And you'll have a lot of shayateen. You'll have shaytan and his army dancing at your wedding. But is that what you want, or do you want angels at your wedding? Do you want angels to be present and have your marriage, your wedding, to be blessed? Which one do you want? You choose. Is this how you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for finding you someone that's suitable for you, that's compatible with you, someone who will complete your life, someone who will share the rest of your life with you? Is this how you thank Allah? By beginning your marriage, your wedding day with music, this is how you thank Allah? Yes, on the other hand, there are some people, you know, may Allah bless them. There's no music at their wedding. Instead, they begin their weddings with Quranic recitation, with Hadith al-Kisa, with religious poetry and anasheed, perhaps with a lecture. I've been invited to some weddings to give a lecture. Some of you are thinking, what a boring wedding to have the Sayyid speak at that wedding. Well, some, they choose to have that. They like to listen maybe to a word of advice on marriage, on how a husband should treat his wife, on how a wife should treat her husband. Some choose that. They want their wedding to be an Islamic wedding. You know, I tell some people this. When I speak about this, about music at weddings, some people say, but Sayyid, you know, if I don't have music at my wedding is going to be boring. Who's going to come to my wedding if there's no music? And if they come thinking that there's music, and then there's no music, my wedding will be remembered as the most boring wedding in history. And I don't want that. I want people to enjoy my wedding, to have a good time at my wedding. I want to have, you know, good memories. The answer, number one, you don't necessarily need to have music. Play religious songs. Play religious anashid. Play poetry and songs of Ahlul Bayt, of the remembrance of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Dhikru Ali in ibadah. The remembrance of Ali ibn Abi Talib is a form of worship. Have that instead. That's an alternative that you could have at your wedding. Let's start this trend. If one person does it, two, three, four, becomes a trend in the community. And we can end, we can put a stop to music at our weddings. This is one. Two, so what? Would you rather have a wedding that's boring, or would you rather have a wedding that disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You're disobeying Allah in that wedding. You're beginning your life with this life partner of yours by disobeying Allah from the first day, from the first start. Which one would you rather have? Be boring or disobey Allah? I'm sure all of you would choose to be boring. Even though you could make your wedding not boring. Just because there's no music, it doesn't mean that your wedding will be boring. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Now let's go a step further. There are some that not just have music, but there's also what? There's dancing at their weddings. There's dancing. Now I'm talking about weddings that are not mixed. Men are by themselves, women are by themselves. Well, obviously men would not be dancing by themselves. That doesn't happen. But women in some cultures, in some countries, Islamic countries, women get up and dance. According to a lot of scholars and maraji, this is not allowed. This is not allowed. Some people think that as long as it's an all-woman wedding, or it's separated, it's segregated, women can play music and they could dance. Who told you? Who said this? Which marja said this? This is not allowed. Even if it's a segregated wedding, this is not allowed. Music is not allowed, and dancing is not allowed. According to a lot of scholars, yes, maybe you might find one or two that say it's allowed, but according to most scholars, this is not allowed. We're talking about segregated weddings, let alone mixed weddings. Let alone mixed weddings. Men and women are together, there's music being played, there's a DJ, and there's a dance floor. And before you know it, they're Muslims at this wedding and they're dancing. They're dancing. What sort of wedding is this? Have we forgotten all of our principles? Have we forgotten about our religion and our faith? What sort of marriage do we want to begin? This is a place for shaitan. You're inviting shaitan, you're telling him, welcome to my wedding, come and do whatever you'd like. This is your playground. Come and do as you please. Is that what you want? I know in some communities, inshallah, this doesn't exist in this community. But there's some people listening to me online. I know in some communities, I will not mention names. Here in North America, in some communities, there's mixed weddings, there's dancing, and they videotape it, and then they go and put it on YouTube for everyone to see that at their wedding, there was dancing. The husband, the bride, the groom danced with his bride. The father danced with his daughter that's a bride. He's proud of it. And he's willing to have everyone in the community see it. It's on the internet. Isn't this a shame? That's it. We've forgotten our principles, our values, our ethics, our manners. We came to Canada, we have to be purely Canadian and pick up all of the values, and we have to have a Canadian wedding. We came to America, we came to Australia, we came to the UK, we came to Europe. We have to have a European wedding, we have to have an American wedding, we have to have an Australian wedding. That's it? We've forgotten all of our values? This is not right. I hope that we can put an end to this dancing at our weddings. Salaam ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Another thing that I have to address is mixed weddings. Mixed weddings. Where there's men and women together in the same hall, and the women are dressed up in the fanciest clothing, in the tightest clothing. There's makeup. You know, and I wish it was simple makeup. But there's like 10 pounds or kilos of makeup and perfume and cologne and all that, and they're mixed. And it's perfectly fine. And that's as if there's nothing wrong. You know, if it's segregated, women could wear whatever they'd like. Go to a segregated wedding, there's no man seeing you. Put on as much makeup as you want. Knock yourself out. Wear whatever you'd like. But if it's a mixed wedding, there's one hall. Men and women are seeing each other. They're sitting next to each other on the same table. This is wrong. Just because it's a wedding, it doesn't make it okay. It doesn't make it okay. Just because it's a wedding. They're mixed. The makeup, the hijab, or lack of hijab. Not the hijab, but the lack of hijab. This is not right. You know, at some weddings, there's some people that look forward to going to weddings because they know that people are going to be dressed up. The guys are going to be dressed up and the girls are going to be dressed up. Basically, it's going to be a fashion show. Obviously, you're going to look forward to those weddings. If it's a fashion show and it's mixed, there's men and women going together, that becomes a fashion show. No, and what's interesting is that the same people that hold these mixed weddings, they go to mixed weddings for their children, for their sons and daughters. If you tell them that we'd like to have a majlis that's mixed, no. No, Mawlana. No, at the majlis, no. At weddings, yes. That's not a problem. Go have a good time at that wedding. But a majlis? No, not the majlis of Abu Abdullah. Men and women sitting in the same room, no partition? Oh, astaghfirullah. This cannot happen. I'm not talking about a specific community. I'm talking about most of our communities. And most of our communities, we have this double standard. This is not right. You want to put a partition? Good. But at the wedding, put a partition over there as well. How come at the wedding you're willing to break all of God's commands and laws so that your daughter enjoys her wedding? Or that your son enjoys his wedding? This is not right. Do we want our wedding and our marriage to have blessings or no? Or to have la'na from Allah and from the angels? Do you want angels to come and bless our weddings or to come and curse us and curse our weddings? We must end this culture, my dear friends. The culture of mixed weddings. This must end. You know, I might sound weird for saying this, but this is the truth. Someone has to say this. We have to end the culture of mixed weddings. We have two choices. Either end the culture of mixed weddings. There's a hall for men and there's a hall for women, and you could do whatever you'd like. Men could dress however they'd like, and women could dress however they'd like, and they could put as much makeup as they'd like. Or the other option is that have a joint wedding, a mixed wedding, but ladies cannot dress up and no makeup. You decide. You decide which one's easier. Of course, the thought of going to a wedding without makeup, that's unheard of. So your option is, segregate them. Have a hall for women and have a hall for men. No mixing. This is the Islamic option. It's not just about the mixing, you see? Some people say, well, Sayyid, are you saying that mixing is haram? Are you saying that at our homes, if we invite guests, we can't sit together? The problem is not with the mixing. The problem is what comes with the mixing. The getting dressed, the lack of hijab, there's no scarf, there's no hijab. There's makeup, there's perfume. It's these things that come with the mixing. But if there's perfect hijab, the lady's covered, she has a scarf on, there's no makeup, there's nothing wrong with mixing. So it's not about the mixing, it's about the things that come with the mixing. That's the problem. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And as you can see, this is not pertain to one culture or another. This is in most of our cultures. In most of our cultures, we have this problem. The music, the dancing, the mixed wedding, this is in most of our cultures. Among the problems at our weddings, most of our weddings, not one culture or the other, at most cultures, the wasteful spending. The wasteful spending. I know your wedding is an important day. I know that it happens once in your lifetime for most people. For others, it happens 6 times in their life. For most people, it's once in their life. And it's an important day. It's a memorable day. You want to spend, you want to have a good time, you want to have your guests have a good time as well. But this doesn't mean that you waste. This doesn't mean that you're allowed to waste. For example, there's people that waste a lot of money on the hall and on the dinner. They go and they find the most expensive hall and the most expensive dinner. Now, I'm not saying hold your wedding at a park or bring food from McDonald's at your wedding. I'm not saying this. But to go and rent the most expensive hall in the city and bring the most expensive food and it goes to waste, this is not right. This is wasting. This is called tabdhir. Tabdhir. إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا أَخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. Those who waste are the brothers of shayateen, of shaytan. وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ تَبْذِيرًا إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا أَخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. Wasting is not allowed. Be moderate. I'm not saying go and, you know, don't rent a hall or have your wedding at your house. No, rent something, but be moderate. Be moderate in your spending. Bring dinner, but be moderate in your spending. You know, that expensive hall that you rent, that expensive hotel, those expensive cards, that expensive dinner, you think they're going to make your marriage a happy marriage? You think it's these things that make a marriage happy and successful? Believe me, it's not these things. Not these things. You could have your wedding at the most expensive place in Montreal, at the most expensive hotel, and bring the most lavish and fanciest dinner. Are you guaranteed that you'll have a successful marriage? That guarantees your successful marriage? No. Believe me, it has nothing to do with the dinner, nor the hotel, nor the hall. It's about your akhlaq. Do you want to have a successful marriage? It's about your akhlaq. About your manners, how you treat one another, how much respect you have for one another, how much you're willing to help one another. This, it has nothing to do with the hall or the dinner or the dress. The dress, hopefully the sisters will not throw anything at me, because the wedding dress is a very important dress. And a lot of the ladies, they go for an expensive dress, you know. We're talking about $2,000, $3,000, $5,000, expensive dresses. I'm not saying to wear a $20 dress. No, wear a nice dress, a good looking dress. But does it have to be the most expensive dress? No. As long as you look nice, you look beautiful, that's what matters. It doesn't have to be the most expensive dress just to show off in front of your friends. In front of your girlfriends, your dress is from this brand name, it's from this store, and this is how much it costs. No, it doesn't have to be that way. I know it's an important dress for you, but also be moderate. Be moderate. There's some that spend on the cake, the cameraman, the roses, the cards, all the little details. All the little details at the wedding. Some couples, they become very creative. I heard of a wedding, you know, this is not Hollywood. I didn't see this in a movie. This is at our communities, at our Islamic communities. I won't say which city it was. The couple decided to free 100 white doves in the middle of the wedding. Do you know how much that costs? Just free those doves. I mean, if they put them in their house, if they gave them as gifts to the people attending, that's understandable. No, just free them in the air. 100 white doves. That costs a lot of money. That's lavish spending. That's wasteful spending. Another couple, they came with a chariot. I don't know if apparently they think they're Cinderella and her Prince Charming. They have to come in a chariot, like a prince and a princess. That's a lot of spending. That's a lot of spending. That's wasteful spending. I'm not saying don't have a nice wedding. Have a nice wedding. Make it creative. Make it nice. But we have to end the culture of wasteful spending on weddings. You know, a lot of youth. I know a lot of youth. I have a lot of friends. They're avoiding getting married because of expensive weddings. They say, I can't afford it. Because a wedding is going to cost me at least $60,000, $70,000. At least. If not $100,000. Where am I going to get that money? I know a lot of youth that are not getting married because of the wedding. Because of the wasteful spending. And if they don't spend that much, they're going to look bad. Because everyone else is doing it. His friends did it. You know, the lady that he wants to marry, her friends did it. They had a nice wedding, nice expensive wedding. How can she have anything less? So this poor man is not able to get married because he can't spend on that wedding. Isn't that a problem? Isn't it a problem when our youth are not being able to get married because of the wasteful spending? Number one, it's wasteful. This is tabdhir. This is not accepted Islamically. Number two, believe me, it's not going to make you happy. It's not going to make you happy. Believe it or not, that couple that released 100 doves, they got divorced. They got divorced, I know. It's the ones that spend the most on their weddings, they end up breaking up. Because these things, they don't bring you happiness. They don't make your marriage happy just because you spent so much on that wedding. Spend on more useful things. Keep that money. Spend it on your children. Keep it for their college fund. Spend it on things that you need. Go on a trip with your family, with your wife, with your husband. Another problem that we have, صلى الله على محمد وعلى محمد. Is expensive dowries. Expensive dowries. And this varies from culture to culture. But in some cultures, the dowry is very expensive. You go and propose to a family, and they agree, but then all of a sudden they throw at you a huge number of a dowry. We want $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 as a gift to our daughter, as a dowry, mahar. That's ridiculous. What, are you selling your daughter? Or are you giving her hand in marriage? You're not selling her. They're not buying her. The man is marrying her. And there's some families, they're not even willing to bargain. Khalas, they said $40,000, it's $40,000. You either bring $40,000 and you marry her, or no, someone else will come and offer that money. What, are you selling merchandise? Are you doing business? Or are you marrying? You're marrying your daughter. You're giving your family, you're giving your daughter to a respected family. Someone who will honor her, someone who will protect her, someone who will respect her. And I know, again, I know a lot of youth that have been avoiding marriage because of expensive dowries. I know several youth, they've told me that they've proposed to a couple of families, and then when they began discussing dowries, when they started discussing the mahar, the dowry, they saw that that family is asking for too much. They're asking for too much. I will say this. Whoever wants to get upset will get upset. I say it for the sake of Allah, as long as it satisfies Allah. Any respectful family will not ask for a big dowry. A respectful family does not ask for a big dowry. Because you're not selling your daughter. You're marrying your daughter. You're not selling her. This gives a bad impression of you when you ask for a high salary, when you ask for a high dowry for your daughter. You know, the dowry, the mahar, it's supposed to be something symbolic. It's a symbolic gift. When a husband gives his wife a dowry, it's a symbolic gift, a token of appreciation. You know, since you've accepted to marry me, this is my token of appreciation. I give you this gift. It doesn't have to be a big number. I've seen some that they give, you know, six digits. I saw a person that gave $1 million as a dowry. $1 million. And I wonder if he's really going to give it to her after the marriage. Is he really going to give her the $1 million? The mahar, the dowry, is supposed to be something symbolic. It's a symbolic gift. It's a token of appreciation. You give it to her as a gift because she accepted the proposal. You're not buying her. And in fact, it's recommended that after the marriage, that the wife, she gives back the dowry. It's recommended. It's mustahab. That after the marriage, she gives it back to her. She gives it back to him. And this is also symbolic. Meaning, this is a gesture that means I did not marry you for your, what? Your money. I married you for you, because of you, because of your qualities, because of your faith, your akhlaq. I didn't marry you for your money. So giving the dowry is a symbolic gesture. Giving it back to the husband is also a symbolic gesture. And if I may make a suggestion, I think that the best dowry to offer your wife is to take her to Hajj. It's to take her to Hajj. Number one, it's not expensive. It's not too expensive. It's not something, you know, ridiculously expensive. Number two, it's a dowry and it's a honeymoon at the same time. Instead of going to the Maldives, instead of going to I don't know where, well, you'll spend ridiculously amount of money and you'll be wasting it for just a couple of days. Instead, go to Hajj. Or go to Ziyarah. Come to the Ziyarah of Imam Hussein alayhi salam in Karbala. That's the best dowry and the best honeymoon. Come and spend it with Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And it'll be unforgettable. You'll never forget it. It'll be a memorable wedding, a memorable dowry, a memorable honeymoon. Let's make this a culture. The culture of having Hajj or Ziyarah as dowries and honeymoons. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Among the bad habits in some cultures, I know in other cultures this does not exist. For example, in Iraq this does not exist. In Iran this does not exist. But I know that in other cultures, Islamic cultures, this does exist. There are some people that get married in the months of Muharram and Safar. I know in some places, as soon as Ashura is over, the 10th of Muharram, the weddings start. Perhaps during the 10 nights, the 10 days of Muharram, there's no weddings. But after that, there's weddings. There's weddings, there's celebrations, and then with all the things that come with weddings, the music and the dancing and the DJ and the mixed sessions and the makeup. And you know, it's not haram. I'm not claiming that it's haram to have a wedding in the month of Muharram or Safar or after Ashura. I'm not claiming that it's haram. But let me ask you something. If, God forbid, a close family member died, will you have your wedding in the same week? Or in the same month? Or perhaps in the same year? You wouldn't. Why? Because you're sad. You're not in the mood to celebrate. It's not an issue of, you know, it's customary, it's not customary. No. You're not in the mood to celebrate because someone important to you just passed away. If, God forbid, a father or a mother or a brother or a sister or a close family member died, are you going to have a wedding in that same week or that same month? Or within those couple of weeks, the first couple of weeks? No. You're not in the mood to celebrate. You're still sad. You're still mourning. You're mourning. It's a sad time for you. Why is it that when it comes to the Ahlul Bayt, why is it that when it comes to Imam Hussein alayhi salam, we only give him 10 days? The month of Muharram, it's a sad month, the entire month. And the month of Safar as well. Thus, in some countries like Iraq and Iran, there's no weddings in those 2 months. Before and after, yes. But not in these 2 months. Because these months are months of mourning. We're sympathizing with the Ahlul Bayt. Right? The hadith says, the hadith of Ahlul Bayt says, شِعَتُنَا مِنَّا خُلِقُوا مِنْ فَاضِلِ طِينَتِنَا يَفْرَحُونَ لِفَرَحِنَا وَيَحْزَنُونَ لِحُزْنِنَا. Our Shia, the Ahlul Bayt say, the Shia are from us. They were created from our soil, from the soil that the Ahlul Bayt were created. This has a very deeper meaning. This is a deep meaning. The soil, because we're all created from soil. We Shia, we were created from the soil of Ahlul Bayt. The leftover of the soil of Ahlul Bayt. We were created from their own soil. We're from them and they're from us. And then the hadith says, يَفْرَحُونَ لِفَرَحِنَا وَيَحْزَنُونَ لِحُزْنِنَا. They are happy when we're happy and they are saddened when we are saddened. When the Ahlul Bayt are happy, we should be happy. That is why some people, they choose to have their weddings on the birthdays of the imams. It's beautiful. Those are good occasions because those are happy occasions. وَيَحْزَنُونَ لِحُزْنِنَا. And they are sad for our sadness. Our Shia are sad for the sadness of the Ahlul Bayt. So I don't understand how a person could have their wedding in the month of Muharram and Safar. Again, I'm not saying that it's haram. But is it appropriate? It's between you and the Ahlul Bayt. Do you feel comfortable? Salaam ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. In some cultures, you know, there's bad habits in every culture. It varies from culture to culture. In some cultures, the night of the wedding, the male side, the groom's side, they recite certain poetry, they say certain things that's disrespectful to the bride's side. That's disrespectful, it's insensitive, and this is not right. To the point that some family members of the bride's side, like her father, they decide not to attend the wedding because they hear something disrespectful. That has to stop. In some cultures, the night of the wedding, the husband has to show proof. I won't give details because I think you know what I'm talking about. And this exists till today. In some cultures, they brought this habit with them here to the West, in America, in Europe. They still have this habit. The morning of the wedding, they have to show proof. And that's very disrespectful. That's very backward. That's very backward. That's very humiliating to the bride. That's humiliating. That's disrespectful. These are, you know, these are habits from the pagans that still exist. And these have to stop. Salla ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. I have a word of advice before we conclude. I have a word of advice to the young brothers and sisters that are engaged, that are getting engaged, they're almost getting married, and they're planning out for their weddings. I say, you know, I'm sure that this is a very happy time for you. It's an exciting time for you. You're engaged. You're about to get married. And I'm sure that you're sitting and planning your wedding. You know, let's do it in the summer. Let's do it when the weather is nice. Let's do it here. Let's do it there. Let's invite this family, but let's not invite that family. You're planning. You're planning ahead. You're planning your wedding. That's fine. But let me tell you something. No matter how much you plan, no matter how much you do, you spend months ahead in planning your wedding, but this does not guarantee you'll have a successful marriage. This does not guarantee that you'll have a happy marriage. You might spend $1 million on your wedding day. $1 million. On your wedding day, you'll spend so much. But does that guarantee that you'll have a happy marriage and that everything will go smoothly? No. No. That's why I tell my young brothers and sisters, you know, you're sitting and you're planning your wedding. At the same time, sit and plan for your marriage. Plan for your marriage. What kind of marriage would you like? What kind of relationship would you like to have with your wife, with your husband? Sit and plan and make decisions that you will always respect one another. That you will always love one another. That you will always be there for one another and help each other. Sit and plan ahead and make decisions from now that you will help each other grow and improve and become more religious. If the young lady is not that religious, sit and plan. Plan with your husband. You want him to make you more religious. You want him to help you improve your hijab. If the man does not wake up for his morning prayers or does not pray on time, sit and plan from now. Ask your fiance or the one that you're marrying, ask her to help you become more religious and pray more on time and to help you get up for salah in the morning. These are the things that you should plan more and concentrate on. Not just the cake and the dress and the ring and the cards and the flowers. These are the things that are more important, my dear friends. Sit and plan on how you'd like to raise your children. Do you want to be strict? Do you want to be lenient? Which kind of akhlaq would you like your children to have? How religious you want them to be? These are the things that you want to plan. Which one of you is going to be strict with the children and which one of you is going to be lenient with the children? Plan ahead. Decide from now. With my children, I'm the lenient one and I make my wife be the tough one. That's why when my children, if they ever want anything, first they come to me because they know I'm the lenient one. Make such decisions. Plan. These are good things to decide. Who's the rough one and who's the lenient one? Who's the one that always says no and who's the one that says yes? Make decisions about your children. Are they allowed to have iPads? How many hours a day will they play with them? Are they allowed to go on the internet? Will you put guidelines and rules? Are they allowed to watch TV? How many hours of TV? Friends, non-Muslim friends. Make decisions from now. Plan ahead before the wedding, before the marriage. So that when you go in the marriage, there's no surprises. There's no saying, well, you know, we didn't talk about this. This wasn't supposed to happen. These are the things that you should worry about and plan ahead of time. Not so much about the wedding. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
If we want to talk about the most perfect wedding, the most Islamic wedding, it was the wedding of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam and Fatima al-Zahra. The most beautiful wedding, the most successful wedding, the most simple wedding, and the wedding that brought the happiest marriage, and the most successful marriage. Imam Ali alayhi salam came to propose to Fatima al-Zahra. First, Abu Bakr came and proposed, if you remember from my lecture. He was rejected. Umar came and proposed to Fatima al-Zahra. He was also denied. They came to him, they both, Abu Bakr and Umar, they came to Imam Ali alayhi salam. They told him, look, we proposed to Rasulullah for Fatima al-Zahra's hand in marriage and we were both denied. You go and propose. Amir Mu'mineen said, okay. He went. He knocked at the door of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Rasulullah greeted him. He sat down and he put his head to the ground, very shy, very embarrassed, not able to say a word. You know, young men today, when they go and propose, they're playing with their phones, you know, they're tweeting, they're taking selfies, they're joking around in front of their father-in-law, you know, no embarrassment, not being shy whatsoever. Have you heard of the story of the young man who went and proposed and he was chewing gum? Let me tell you this story. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
A young man goes and he proposes to a father and he was chewing gum. You know, in our culture, that's very disrespectful. You go and you're chewing gum in front of your future father-in-law. So the father-in-law, the man, the father of the lady, he told him, do you always chew gum in front of adults? He said, no. But you know, it's this nicotine gum. Told him, well, why are you chewing that kind of gum? He said, well, you know, I'm trying to quit smoking. He said, oh, so you smoke? He said, well, yeah, you know, when you're trying to quit taking drugs, you start smoking cigarettes. He told him, so you used to take drugs? He said, well, obviously, when you're in jail, you learn to take drugs. He said, you're in jail. He said, well, yeah, I mean, when you kill people, you go to jail. He told him, you killed someone? He said, yeah. He told him, who? He said, some father, I went, I proposed to his daughter, he refused, so I killed him. Imam Ali alayhi salam, he comes in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, his head is down. He doesn't say a word. He's embarrassed. He's shy. He couldn't even say that I'm here to propose. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he began. He took the initiative. He told him, Ya Ali, perhaps you're here to propose to my daughter, Fatima. He said, indeed, Ya Rasulullah. Indeed. Rasulullah got up and he came and he asked Fatima to Zahra alayhi salam. He said that Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, your cousin, is here proposing to you. What do you say? Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam also, she put her head down, not saying a word. You know, not like young ladies today when a handsome guy comes and proposes. You hear the shouting from inside, you know, the extreme shouting, and they're overjoyed. Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam put her head down. She didn't say a word. She didn't say a word. And Rasulullah here said his famous statement. He said, Subhanallah, sukutuha radaha. That her silence is a sign of her, what? Acceptance. Acceptance. And this became a general law. A general law. That if a young lady, she's proposed to and she remains silent, then it's a sign of her, what? Acceptance. Because if she does not accept, she'll say something. But if she accepts, she's embarrassed in front of her father to say so. She remained quiet. Rasulullah realized that she accepted. Jibra'il comes down and he said, Ya Rasulullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has recited their nikah up in the sky among the angels. Among the angels, the nikah of Ali ibn Abi Talib and Fatima al-Zahra has been recited. And Allah says, Zawwij an-nura min an-nur. Zawwij Ali min Fatima. Give the light to the light. Give Ali ibn Abi Talib to Fatima al-Zahra. صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. They prepared for the wedding. They prepared for the marriage. Rasulullah asked Ali ibn Abi Talib, what do you own, Ya Ali? What do you own? What do you have? He said, Ya Rasulullah, I only own two things. Two things. My sword and my shield. These are the two things that I own. And I own a very small house. Amir al-Mu'mineen, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, as for your sword, then you can't sell it. Because we need your sword. Islam needs your sword. As for your shield, you don't need your shield, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Go and sell your shield. He went and he sold it. And with the price of the shield, he was able to furnish his house. Very simple furniture. He furnished the house. The night of the wedding, Fatima al-Zahra, the famous story. Fatima al-Zahra had a wedding dress. prepared for her. The night of her wedding, a poor lady came and knocked at the door and asked for something. Fatima al-Zahra goes, she left everything, she came and she gave her the wedding dress. She gave her her wedding dress. Rasulullah asked her, he told her, why did you give your wedding dress? She said, because the Quran says, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحَبُّونَ, that you will not reach righteousness until you give that which you love. You know, there's people, they donate the things that they don't need. The old clothes, the whatever that's old, they give it to the poor. True righteousness is when you give the things that you need the most, the things that you like the most. She gave her wedding dress. On the day of the wedding, it was simple food. Simple food. It was one sheep with some dates and some milk. That was very good food back then. And it was enough for everyone. It was enough for everyone. There was no music. There was no DJ. There was no dancing. Instead, there was poetry recited. فَاطِمَةُ خَيْرُ نِسَاءِ الْبَشَرِ وَمَنْ لَهَا وَجْهٌ كَوَجْهِ الْقَمَرِ, that Fatima is the greatest lady from all of the women, and who has a face glowing like a moon, like the face of Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. Beautiful wedding, beautiful people, beautiful bride, beautiful groom. And when they finally met, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa took the hands of Ali ibn Abi Talib and the hand of Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam, and they put their hands together, and he told Fatima, Fatima, you're marrying the best of husbands. This is the best husband. Take care of your husband. And Ya Ali, you are marrying the best of wives. This is the best wife. Take care of my daughter, Ya Ali. I'm entrusting you with my daughter, Ya Ali. This was the best wedding in the Islamic history, between the best husband and the best wife and the best children. Yes. And this is an example for us. Sallallahu alayhi wa Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. There was another wedding, and that wedding was also by Imam Ali alayhi salam, long after his wife Fatima al-Zahra died. Fatima al-Zahra had asked him to remarry after her martyrdom, after her death. So Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam decided to remarry. He came to his brother Aqil, told him, I want you to find me a wife. Which kind of wife? Aqil was a scholar on the lineage of the Arab people. He knew the lineage. He knew the tribes. He knew the family members. He told him, which kind of wife? He said, I want a wife that comes from a brave family, a brave line. Brave? Bravery? This is not a quality that men look for in women. They look for beauty, beautiful eyes, beautiful hair, intelligence, but not bravery and courage. Bravery and courage is a quality that you would want in a man. It's a good quality in a man, not in a woman. Even though it's a good quality in a woman, but it's not something that you look for. He said, wow, what would you do with a brave woman? He said, so that Allah will give me a son from her that will be an investment on a very difficult day. On a very difficult day. And indeed, he found him Fatima al-Kilabiyya. On the night of their wedding, I mentioned this two nights ago, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam discovered, even though he wasn't looking for beauty, he discovered that she's extremely beautiful. Her outer appearance is very beautiful. He wanted to discover her inner beauty. He asked her, do you have any request? This is the night of her wedding. Any request? She said, yes, I request that you change my name, the name of Fatima. Told her, why? You have the most beautiful name, the name of Fatima. She said, yes, because your children, Hassan and Hussein and Zainab and Umm Kulthum, when they hear the name of Fatima, they will remember their mother Fatima, who died at a small age when they were young, and their hearts will be broken. They will remember their young mother Fatima, and I don't want their hearts to be broken because of me. So change my name, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. And he named her Umm al-Baneen. Umm al-Baneen. And indeed, Umm al-Baneen means the mother of children. And indeed, Allah gave her several children. He gave her four boys, and the first was Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Al-Abbas, when he was born, he was so beautiful that they called him Qamar al-Ashira, the moonlight of the family. So beautiful. His face was glowing.